So welcome everyone, and thank you for logging on to this webinar. I am Sherry Faye. I'm finishing up my PhD in radiochemistry at University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and I will be starting my postdoc as an NSSC postdoc starting early next year. I will be presenting my dissertation research on the simultaneous determination of multiple actinide elements in a variety of soils utilizing a standardized sequential extraction protocol. And I would like to thank NSSC for the opportunity to present this work to you today through this webinar. So first, I'll just give an outline of what I'm going to discuss today. We're going to talk about the background and importance of this work, the goals of the research, including extraction chromatography method verification, sequential extraction method verification and capability expansion, and complete dissolution studies. I'll discuss my results, conclusions from the work, and potential future work. So the importance of this work, radionuclide contamination risk is often based on the total concentration of those radionuclides in the environment. Unfortunately, that doesn't give us the whole picture of the potential for mobility and bioavailability of the contaminants within the soil. And this image here just shows the variety of ways radionuclides can be released and mobilized throughout the environment. The release conditions are dependent upon chemical speciation, and that's the form in which the radionuclide is in when it's released. But there is no current method for the direct measurement of the solid phase speciation at concentration levels seen in the environment. Therefore, the best approach, which is often used, is to indirectly assess the contaminant association with primary geochemical host phases of the soils and sediments. And that's done by sequential extraction, which is the selective dissolution of soil phases with increasingly aggressive chemical treatment. The image here on the right is depicting a soil particle and the different geochemical host phases that we can define and leach chemicals selectively from. So this method can provide information on biological availability, the potential for mobilization and transport of the contaminants within the environment, and also the origin of the sediment. So some brief history on sequential extraction. It dates back to the 17th century, but more recently, there have been several procedures that analyze extraction of both stable elements and radionuclide contaminants from soils and sediments. For the stable elements, there are three procedures that come up over and over again in the literature. The Tessier procedure from 1979 is a procedure that is highly cited and often used in a modified form for both stable element and radionuclide extraction. It contains five operationally defined fractions, so that's what I was talking about with the geochemical host phases. And from this research, they found that the carbonate fraction can be highly variable in the leaching results, depending on the particle size, percentage, and the type of carbonate in the sample. They also found that the reagent they use to extract contaminants from the organic phase may not be very phase specific, but other reagents that were used to extract it were not, were leaching from other phases that they shouldn't have been leaching from. Another highly cited procedure is from Miller et al. In 1986. This is an eight-step procedure plus an acid digestion at the end. They looked at the order of dissolution and phase selectivity. And finally, the BCR method is the most recent in 1992, and it's a simplified three-step procedure that looks at soil phases or contaminants that can be extracted from the acid soluble phase, the organic phase, and the residual phase, which is the residual phase represents contaminants that are highly insoluble and less likely to be mobile within the environment. The BCR method was developed to become a standardized procedure that could be applied to reference materials so that reference materials could be released to the research community to get a better understanding of the association of stable element contaminants within the soils. Switching to history based specifically for radionuclide sequential extraction, Clark et al. In 1996 evaluated both the Tessier and the Miller procedures applied to radionuclide extraction, and they tested these on soils from the seepage pond. They found that the Tessier method didn't have a good phase definition for the organic phase. They also recommend the addition of a fraction to estimate refractory concentrations of these radionuclides. Schultz et al. In 1998 is where the standardization for radionuclide extraction began. In the mid-90s, there was a speciation workshop at NIST where they determined that they needed standardized sequential extraction procedure to apply to standard basically what the BCR method was doing, but for radionuclide extraction. Schultz analyzed for americium, plutonium, and uranium extraction from the IAEA 135 marine sediment reference material. They used six target phases. It was based off the Tessier procedure, and they switched up. They moved the organic fraction to number two instead of number four, because you often see organics coating the mineral, so they wanted to extract that off first. And then they added a six fraction for refractory concentrations, which Clark had recommended. Outola et al. Is what this work is based off of. It was a procedure published in 2009. They analyzed for maximum uranium and plutonium extraction from two NIST standard reference materials, lake sediment and ocean sediment. And the goal was to create a standardized procedure based on two very different reference materials, so the same procedure could be applied based no matter what soil geochemical host phases that you had in your sample. So the goal of this work is to verify the work by Outola et al. And then expand upon that. So first of all, we're going to verify that method. But before we do that, we want to look at the capability expansion as well. So we want to be able to simultaneously analyze the leaching of multiple actinide elements. And to do that, we need to examine extraction chromatography-based separations and how they'll work with this procedure. So that's the first step that we'll talk about. The next step is verifying this procedure that was done by Outola et al. And we're going to do that by repeating five replicates of her experiments with the optimized parameters. Then we're going to apply that optimized procedure to two more soil reference materials. And then finally, add a six fraction of complete dissolution to determine any refractory concentrations of radionuclides. So first of all, extraction chromatography method verification. The previous study, Outola et al., utilized anion exchange for radioanalytical separations. They were only analyzing for leaching of uranium and plutonium. Since we want to analyze for more radionuclides at the same time, we wanted to switch to extraction chromatography-based separations. They're quicker and more efficient, so it offers the simultaneous separation of these radionuclides. We chose a procedure by Maxwell et al. To do this, and the goals for this part of the research were to first verify the method that it can be repeated here at UNLV and compare that to the literature values. We also want to see if there are any effects from the sequential extraction reagents on the separation efficiencies from this procedure. So the separation procedure by Maxwell et al. Is titled Rapid Column Extraction Method for Actinides in Soil. It utilizes iChrome extraction chromatography resins, TEVA, TRUE, and DGA. Then they're stacked in that order on an iChrome vacuum box. Typically, before we do separations, we have to do a lot more chemistry to pre-concentrate the actinides after we dissolve them. We'll talk about that in some later steps. But once you have your actinides pre-concentrated and in the column load solution, you need to do a few valence adjustments, which are shown in the first bubble here. And after that, you load your sample onto the column, which, as I said, it was TEVA, TRUE, and then DGA cartridges stacked on each other. You'll rinse your sample tube with 3 milliliters of 6 molar nitric acid and then add that rinse to the columns. Your thorium and plutonium are going to stick to your TEVA and then elute with the chemicals shown in the third bubble. uranium will flow through the TEVA and stick on to the TRU, and americium will flow through TEVA and TRU and stick on the DGA. Americium is a little bit trickier because you can get interferences from rare earth elements, so you need to do some more purifications on a hot plate before finally purifying americium using TEVA and one molar hydrochloric acid. Once we have our separations complete, we need to prepare our sources for counting. We do this with a cerium fluoride microprecipitation. You just add a cerium carrier and then hydrochloric acid. It precipitates your actinide fluorides and the cerium fluoride onto a filter. We use the filtration manifold. It's a 12-stage filtration manifold from Millipore. And I don't know if you see my cursor or not, but the samples, the filters sit on the support plate, and you pour your sample through the sample cups. The precipitate is caught on the filters, and then that's what we use to count. We mount those filters on stainless steel planchettes and then count them via alpha spectroscopy, typically for anywhere between 1 to 5 weeks, depending on the concentration of the sample. So for the method verification, we analyze triplicate samples for each tracer that we're using in this research: thorium-229, uranium-232, plutonium-242, and americium-243, each of these separately. We added the tracer to a 50 milliliter centrifuge tube and evaporated that to dryness, then reconstituted it in the column load solution. We ran everything through the extraction chromatography procedure, and eluents were collected from each step and mounted via the cerium fluoride microprecipitation. So these are the results for the method verification. Basically, what it's showing is that each of the four tracers are eluting where they should and close to 100% recoveries, except for plutonium. Now, that's a separate case. We're assuming, since we don't see that extra 20% plutonium that was lost in any of the eluents, that there's possibility of the valence state adjustments weren't complete, so we lost some plutonium from that, but that's something we need to investigate in the future. This is just zoomed in on everything except the tracers where they're supposed to elute, showing that everything has less than a 1% recovery. Nothing is breaking through where it shouldn't be. The only exception is uranium from the three molar nitric strip, and that's actually a cleaning step of the TEVA. So any uranium that may not have passed through to the TRU and stuck on the TEVA has an extra cleaning step. So you can actually see that's beneficial to do that, because we get almost 2.5% of that uranium that's stuck to the TEVA. And this is just the literature comparison, our work versus Maxwell, the paper that we're using the procedure from, showing that our results are in good agreement, except for the plutonium, which will need to be investigated in the future. So next, we're going to move on to investigating any potential problems with the sequential extraction reagents on the separation efficiencies. So what we did for this is prepare triplicate samples of each sequential extraction reagent separately, and added tracers of uranium-232, plutonium-242, and americium-243. Once those were added, we evaporated everything to dryness and reconstituted for pre-concentration. We did a ferric hydroxide and a cerium fluoride pre-concentration before running columns. And as discussed before, we ran through the separation procedure and mounted our samples via cerium fluoride microprecipitation. So these are the sequential extraction reagents and the maximum concentrations used by Outola et al. This is just showing what each sample consisted of as far as reagents and concentrations. I mentioned the actinide pre-concentrations. We do two of these. First, the ferric hydroxide co-precipitation is to concentrate the actinides into a smaller mass and eliminate major interferences that could interfere with the separations or the alpha counting. The cerium fluoride microprecipitation is done to reduce the sample mass even further and remove any matrix interferences. Once the precipitate from the cerium fluoride is collected, we collect that onto a filter, just as we do for the source preparation, but then we'll need to wash this precipitate off of the filter And we do that with about 10 milliliters of free molar nitric and 0.25 molar boric acid. We tested this with just tracers and found that we got over 90% removal of the precipitate from the filter using this method. So here are the results for the reagent interference study. What we're seeing is most of the fractions for most of the elements, we're getting a recovery of 75% or greater, which is good. Some problems that we see, uranium extraction from the organic phase is pretty low. It's close to 60%. And we're expecting that's from incomplete and inconsistent oxidation of the uranium to the plus six state, which would mean it's not in its more mobile form and its more soluble form. We also see reduced plutonium extraction from the exchangeable phase, a possibility of plutonium complexing with magnesium from the magnesium chloride could reduce the extraction from plutonium in this phase. We also see reduced americium in that same phase, the exchangeable phase, and this could be possibly from americium complexing with chlorine from the magnesium chloride. And finally, we have slightly lower recovery of plutonium from the iron and manganese oxide phase. This could potentially be because of incomplete reduction of plutonium, which has been seen in the literature that the use of hydroxylamine, which is the reagent to reduce in that phase, in that target phase, can decrease significantly with variations in pH. So conclusions for this section, we saw that there is no significant breakthrough for any of the elements that we're analyzing, and our results are comparable to the literature except for the plutonium. Most recoveries are above 75% and similar to the control samples. In future work, we didn't analyze thorium for the method verification, so we will need to do that since we're analyzing for thorium, and also investigate the losses in plutonium, possibly due to the pre-column balance adjustment. So we agreed that we would move forward with this procedure since the results are this mostly above 75%. The fractions that are lower than 75%, what that means to the following work is basically we'll have to just count longer. Since we're tracing our recoveries throughout the entire procedure, we'll still know how much recovery we get from our samples. We'll just need to count longer for better counting statistics. So the next step is the verification and capability expansion of the standardized sequential extraction protocol. So there are many sequential extraction procedures in the literature. Unfortunately, they all seem to use different reagents, different number of target phases, different definitions of target phases. They analyze for different elements, both stable and radioactive, and from a variety of different soils and sediments. Because of this, you can't compare any of the literature to other literature, and that's fairly unfortunate. So we want to be able to do that. So a standardized sequential extraction protocol has been started, developed at NIST by Outola et al., as I mentioned previously, but we want to expand on the capabilities of that procedure for the analysis capabilities of multiple actinides at the same time and also the application of that procedure to a variety of soils. So the goals for this are to verify the standardized procedure developed at NIST by running five replicates of an optimized procedure to determine the repeatability at different laboratories. Then we want to add the capabilities for simultaneous analysis of multiple actinides by tracing americium and thorium during the verification experiments. We want to apply the standardized sequential extraction protocol to various soil and sediment samples, so IAEA 447 and 384, in addition to the NIST reference materials that were analyzed during the verification studies. And finally, monitor trace elements to determine the phase selectivity. So from stable elements, we can get a better idea of how the procedure is behaving. So we're going to analyze for aluminum, iron, manganese, and strontium by ICP-MS. So this is the sequential extraction procedure. Again, just like most of the procedures we mentioned earlier, it's a modification of the Tessier procedure, and this was the one that was developed by Outola et al. At NIST. The first fraction is the exchangeable fraction. The reagent is magnesium chloride, and it basically just extracts any contaminants that are loosely bound to the soil. The next step is the carbonate phase, or the acid soluble phase. For this, we use a buffered solution of ammonium acetate, and that drops the pH from 7 to 5. So anything that's subject to extract with a drop in pH will leach out at that time. The iron and manganese oxide step, we use hydroxylamine, hydrochloride, and acetic acid. And this is going to reduce our solution and leach out anything that's reducible. The fourth fraction is organic material, and we do this on a hot plate with hydrogen peroxide and 0.02 molar nitric acid. And this is an oxidizing step. And finally, anything that's left within the sediment, we attack with a 4 molar nitric acid at 90 degrees C. This is a persistently bound phase. So the chemistry involved in this is we weigh out the sample. It's 12 grams of sample per 180 milliliters of reagent. So we'll weigh out the sample, 12 grams of it into a 250 milliliter centrifuge bottle, and then we'll add 35 milliliters of deionized water to expand the clay minerals. We let that sit overnight. The next morning, we'll add 180 milliliters of magnesium chloride to that sediment that has been previously wet and set it in a water bath at the time and the temperature that was shown on the previous slide. And that's our reaction time for that. Once that reaction time is complete, we'll remove the bottle from the water bath and centrifuge it for half an hour at 3,000 RPM. We'll then pour off the leachate into a plastic bottle and save that. We then rinse the solid with 25 milliliters of the magnesium chloride, centrifuge again, pour it off into the same bottle, and then rinse with 25 milliliters of deionized water, centrifuge, and pour the leachate into the same bottle. Once we have all our leachate collected, we'll filter it and acidify it with nitric acid. So that's just one fraction. So once that one fraction is complete, we have our leachate in a bottle and our sediment that we started with in the 250 milliliter centrifuge bottle. We'll then add the second reagent, repeat all of that, and do that for each of the five fractions. The only fraction that's different is fraction 4, and that is done on a hot plate. So we'll slurry the sediment out of the centrifuge bottle using the 0.02 molar nitric acid, and that's done with 70 milliliters of the nitric acid. And then we'll add hydrogen peroxide, 110 milliliters drop-wise, until the reaction is complete. So for actinide analysis, this can be quite time-consuming. When we start with a sequential extraction, that can take approximately 1 week. Then we need to add the tracers and evaporate that solution to dryness, which takes 3 to 4 days. Pre-concentration takes a day, separations 1 to 2 days, and then sample mounting is 2 hours. Alpha counting can take anywhere between 1 and 5 weeks. I can mention that we base all of our counting statistics on recovery of the tracer and not the radionuclide that we're looking for in our sample. Since we don't know what phase that the radionuclide is going to leach out or in what percentage it's going to leach out, we could end up counting these samples. Say if we had a radionuclide in a fraction that had a 5% recovery, we would have to count that sample for a few months to get good counting statistics. So due to that fact, we base all our counting statistics on the tracer and not the sample. So total time from start to finish is anywhere between 3 to 7 weeks, depending on how long you count your sample for. So first, the method verification. We're going to repeat 5 replicates of the standardized sequential extraction protocol by Outola et al., where she analyzed for uranium-238 and plutonium-239-240 extraction from ocean sediment and lake sediment reference materials. So just some quick information about these reference materials. The ocean sediment is a mix of Irish Sea and Chesapeake Bay sediment in about a 1 to 200 ratio. It did this way so the researchers using the reference material would have a significant amount of contamination from the IRC sediment, but it was downblended with the Chesapeake Bay sediment to get to be more representative of environmental samples. Plutonium is 10.4 becquerels per kilogram concentration, and uranium is 12 becquerels per kilogram, but it is an uncertified value. For the lake sediment, it was collected from Lake Perch in Canada, which is it's part of the Chalk River nuclear facilities. It has approximately an order of magnitude higher activity concentrations than typical environmental samples. The sediment has about 40% organic content, and then the activity concentrations for uranium and plutonium are shown there. So for the method verification results, we see for uranium from lake sediment and plutonium from lake and ocean sediment, nearly 100% recovery using the sequential extraction. We only see uranium recovery from ocean sediment at about 40%. So what this represents for mobility is we're expecting the any extraction from the first three target phases, so the exchangeable, carbonate, and iron and manganese oxides, the three phases that are on the bottom of the column plots, the greater extraction in those three phases represents a higher mobility of that actinide and that sediment. So you can see that the uranium and ocean sediment is going to be the least mobile and the least concern for bioavailability. We see that uranium extraction from lake sediment is pretty high in the carbonate phase. We're expecting uranium complexing with the carbonate and becoming mobile that way. There's also a significant amount of uranium in the organic phase, which points to the geochemistry of the sample having some kind of effect on the extraction since it has such a high organic content. The same is seen for plutonium from ocean sediment with a high carbonate content. We see a lot of plutonium leaching from the carbonate phase. So these are results for ocean sediment compared to the literature. We see a couple issues pop up here. Plutonium in the carbonate phase was higher, extracted much higher from our work than it was from Outola et al. This could possibly point to a problem with phase selectivity. And everything else kind of matches, but it's hard to say with that carbonate extraction being so high from UNLV. For uranium extraction from ocean sediment, our results match very well to those of Outola et al. For both concentrations in the specific target phases as well as the total concentration. For lake sediment, we saw issues with plutonium leaching from lake sediment, mainly in the organic and the residual phase. What we think happened here is since the reaction conditions for the organic fraction are less defined than the other fractions, since they're done on a hot plate and not controlled in that 250 milliliter centrifuge bottle in the water bath, that the plutonium in replicates that didn't leach out completely from that organic phase were seeing leach out in the residual phase. Thus, the difference from the results between UNLV and Outola and from the high error bar seen in both of those fractions. We also see slight differences in uranium leaching from lake sediment between the two studies. The main differences are in the carbonate phase and the organic phase, with Outola seeing higher leaching from the carbonate phase in the lake sediment. So next we're going to move on to the analysis of multiple actinide elements. What we did for this is basically, while we did the previous experiments of the method verification, we also added tracers of thorium-229 and americium-243. We analyzed these leachates in the same manner as the uranium and plutonium samples, and the recovery was monitored for thorium-232 and americium-241 from both lake and ocean sediment. And this table here just shows the certified values of the lake and ocean sediment for thorium-232 and americium-241. And it's important to note that the activity concentration reported for americium-241 from ocean sediment is an uncertified value. So for americium results, we see very different extraction behaviors of americium from both lake and ocean sediment. We're seeing a high amount of americium in the carbonate phase extracted from ocean sediment, which ties into the extraction being based off the geochemistry of the sediment because of the high carbonate content. But we see that in lake sediment, americium is much more immobile or insoluble, with much of it being extracted in the residual phase. Thorium is quite the opposite. Thorium is known to be one of the more immobile elements overall for actinides. And we're seeing that most of it is leached, especially from ocean sediment in the residual phase. And we're seeing some leached out, the majority of the thorium from lake sediment in the carbonate phase. This is just a comparison of all four elements and their leaching behaviors from ocean sediment. The plot on the left is the recovery as we saw it. So this is basically showing that, for example, thorium, we only got a little over 80% of our thorium back based on the reference values on the certificate for that reference material. The uranium is the 40% that we saw that I showed in a previous slide. Americium, as I noted a few slides ago, that was an uncertified value, and that explains why we're seeing higher than 120% recovery for that. The value listed on the certificate was 10 millibecquerels per kilogram, and it was a range anywhere from 7 to 18. So if we base our calculations off any different number, we could get anywhere between 70% and over 130% recovery, just based on the range and the values reported on the certificate. The plot on the right is normalizing the recovery of each element to 100%, so you can get a better visualization of what percentage of each element was leached in each fraction. We see that thorium is the most immobile, with almost 80% of it in the residual phase, which is the most immobile. Plutonium and americium match each other fairly well, and they're much more mobile than the primordial thorium and uranium. So for lake sediment, we see kind of the opposite. So thorium is still the most immobile. When uranium, plutonium, and americium extraction is all near 100% from the lake sediment. When we normalize it to 100% recovery, we see that thorium and uranium are more mobile, which is the opposite of what we saw in the ocean sediment. Plutonium and uranium are much more immobile in the ocean sediment. So next, we're going to apply this procedure, the sequential extraction procedure, to two more reference materials to investigate the plutonium extraction. We only analyzed plutonium for this. We didn't look at uranium, americium, or thorium at this point, basically just for the sake of time. And so we analyzed the plutonium extraction from two additional reference materials, and we did five replicates for each material. The first was IEA-447, which is moss soil. It's a combination of moss and the soil that it grew in from an abandoned mine in the mountains in Hungary. It is expected to contain a approximately 40-year global fallout record due to the relatively undisturbed growing conditions of the moss. It has a relatively high organic content similar to the lake sediment, and it has 5.3 becquerel per kilogram of plutonium-239-240. IEA-384, Fingatalpa sediment, is on the opposite end of that section, spectrum. It's collected from the Fangataufa Lagoon in French Polynesia, where the French conducted several nuclear tests, and contains more direct fallout information from that nuclear weapons testing. Sediment is nearly 100% calcium carbonate and has a much higher activity concentration of plutonium-239-240 at 107 becquerels per kilogram. It also has a high enough concentration of plutonium-238 that we were able to analyze it relatively easily, and that's 39 becquerels per kilogram of the plutonium-238. So this shows the results for the plutonium leaching from the various soils. We're seeing trends in leaching based on the soil geochemistry, mainly in fractions 2 and 5, where fractions 1, 3, and 4, they're relatively the same leaching for each reference material that we're looking at. But we are seeing a notably higher extraction of plutonium from the carbonate phase in the Fangataufa and the ocean sediment, which are sediments that are high in carbonate content. Next, we're going to look at the stable element analysis to provide information on the leaching of these stable elements to provide insight into the phase selectivity of the procedure. We had saved 50 milliliters of the leachate from sequential extraction before we added the tracers and did all the chemistry for the actinide analysis. We then analyzed those leachates for the stable elements, aluminum, iron, manganese, and strontium. We did this by ICP-MS. And we looked at aluminum, iron, and manganese to determine phase selectivity, and strontium to get a better idea of fission product behavior. So the stable element results show a high extraction of magnesium or manganese from lake sediment. Actually, this is the same scenario as the americium extraction. The values for the stable elements on the certificate for lake and ocean sediment had high errors, plus 50% and minus 30%. So because you're seeing it over 100%, it basically just is an effect of the error of the measurement that was reported on the certificate. So magnesium or manganese is more soluble than the rest of the elements that are shown here. So we're expected to see this leach out more completely and more in the first three fractions, which is what we're seeing. For iron in lake and ocean sediment, it should be noted that for the lake sediment, the signal for iron was saturated on the ICP-MS, so it's not shown here. But it appears that the extraction behaviors of iron from lake and ocean sediment are quite similar. For aluminum, the lake sediment, aluminum extracts from more completely, but still not at 100%. And then aluminum appears to be much more insoluble in ocean sediment than it is in lake sediment. Strontium is an interesting case because though we only see approximately 40 to 50% total leaching from both lake and ocean sediment, a great percentage of what does leach out is in the first three fractions, which are more soluble. So this potentially points at two different chemical forms of strontium that were originally in the lake and ocean sediment. So just a quick comparison to the literature showing that the results that we got are very comparable to what was seen by Outola et al. For the extraction of the stable elements. And again, for the lake sediment, that's just missing the organic fraction of iron from lake sediment. So conclusions for this section of the work, the method verification studies showed that the repeatability is possible. We just need to better define the reaction parameters for the organic phase. The addition of americium and thorium analysis showed differences in extraction behaviors based on the element, and more specifically, whether or not it was primordial or anthropogenic. Application to various soil types showed differences in the extraction behavior based on the host phases of the sediment. So like we discussed, we're seeing a lot of leaching from the carbonate phase in reference materials that have a high amount of carbonate. Evaluations of stable elements showed good phase selectivity. I didn't mention calcium is a very, very good indicator of extraction in the carbonate phase. However, we were not able to analyze for calcium on the ICP-MS because of pretty severe interferences. We do have an ICP-AES that is finally a new one to replace our old one that we lost over a year ago. So hopefully in the near future, we can analyze calcium and get a better idea of the phase selectivity for the carbonate phase. So future work for this section is to apply a total dissolution of the previously leached ocean sediment and see if we can, especially that uranium that we only saw 40% extract, if we do a complete dissolution, can we get that other 60% extracted from the ocean sediment? And also analyze uranium, americium, and thorium extraction from the IAEA reference materials so we have a more complete picture. So speaking of a complete dissolution to try to account for the uranium that wasn't seen extracted from the ocean sediment, the last step of this work is evaluating the a sixth fraction, so the addition of a sixth fraction for complete dissolution. This is going to basically give us information on actinides that weren't extracted in the first five phases and that will represent very insoluble forms of actinides. So this work and other studies in the literature show incomplete dissolution of elements from soils, and we're doing this in an attempt to obtain 100% actinide recovery, the complete dissolution step. This will be applied after the five steps of the sequential extraction. So the goals of this are to test microwave digestion and fission procedures for complete dissolution of the soil samples, choose the best procedure based on the time of dissolution, completeness, and the procedure safety, and then finally apply the chosen procedure to previously sequentially leached fingatelpa sediment. That's the IAEA 384. And we're using that because it has a higher activity concentration by at least an order of magnitude than any of the other sediments, so we could count quicker. So we looked at two different microwave digestion procedures, the EPA 3052 method for soil dissolution and a carbonate-specific microwave digestion by Kemp et al. For fusion, we used an EPA method for sodium hydroxide fusion for concrete matrices, and we chose this based on the high carbonate content of the fingatelpa sediment. So I'm not going to go into detail on this and bore you with the procedural parameters, but basically the microwave digestion procedure for soil just uses concentrated nitric acid and concentrated hydrofluoric acid. You put it in vessels, you put your sample, the acids, and a tracer in a microwave vessel, seal it, and put it in the microwave for the conditions shown on this slide. After that's done, you'll need to do the ferric hydroxide and cerium fluoride pre-concentrations and the separations mentioned previously. Carbonate-specific microwave digestion is similar in that you add your sample plus the tracer, but you're adding acetic acid first to the vessel and placed on a hot plate, and this is done to release the carbon dioxide gas. For those of you unfamiliar with it, the carbonate, the fingatelpa sediment has a high carbonate content, and if you add acid to it, it's basically like taking a soda bottle and shaking it up. So we don't really want to have that happen in the sealed vessel and then add microwave radiation to it. So this step is just to evolve the carbon dioxide gas before we seal it and put it in the microwave. So we microwave the sample, and then we add 10 milliliters of 4% boric acid. This is to destroy the fluorides that we added from the hydrofluoric acid, and then microwave it again. This has the same post-dissolution treatment as the previous microwave digestion procedure with the pre-concentrations and the separations. Fusion, it looks like it's more complicated because there's, you see two slides of procedure shown here, but it's really not. So you measure out your sediment sample, add the tracer, you put it in a zirconium crucible, you evaporate that to dryness, so it's dry before it goes in the furnace. You add 3.75 grams of a sodium hydroxide flux to the crucible, and then you heat it at 600 degrees C for 15 minutes. Once that's done, you do basically the rest of what's represented here is several pre-concentrations to get rid of any matrix interferences and pre-concentrate your actinides into a smaller mass. So since these pre-concentrations are built into the procedure, it decreases the time of the procedure, and it makes it a little bit simpler than the two microwave digestion procedures. Once your sample is dissolved, you filter it, wash the filter with a 3-molar nitric, 0.25 molar boric acid, and reconstitute it in the column load solution. You run your columns, mount your sample for alpha spectroscopy, and then count it. So results. For the EPA soil method, we saw a precipitate form, and it was had a much greater sample mass than we started with. So we're assuming, due to the high carbonate content of our sample, that we had a calcium fluoride precipitate form. We verified that by XRD and then ruled out this procedure because we can't have a precipitate forming. We actually saw 95% of our plutonium recovery in the precipitate, and the other 5% was where we were hoping to get it in the solution. So for the carbonate-specific microwave digestion and the fusion methods were actually very similar in the recoveries. You can see in the table here the recoveries of the tracer and the two different plutonium isotopes that we were looking at. The microwave digestion procedure, however, took a lot longer because of the fact that we had to evaporate our sample and then redissolve it and run the two pre-concentrations that were mentioned in the beginning of this work. Whereas the fusion procedure, those pre-concentrations were built in. So now we're going to look at we chose a fusion procedure to proceed, and we're going to look at the fusion of the previously leached Fangataufa sediment. So following the sequential extraction of the Fangataufa sediment, we saved the sediment, and then we took a 0.25 gram sample of that sediment and ran it through the fusion procedure. We analyzed plutonium-238 and plutonium-239-240 extraction to see if there's any residual plutonium left in the sediment following the sequential leaching. So what we see here is just a couple things. We're seeing that the isotopes of plutonium are behaving similarly to each other, which is expected. And we're also seeing that though it was a very small recovery, we did see some plutonium, both 238 and 239-240, extract from this, the fusion procedure. This, when you add it all together, we get, within the error, we're close to 100% recovery for the plutonium-238 and the plutonium-239-240. So conclusions for this section, the soil method was eliminated based on the precipitate formation. The fusion method was recommended based on the time and the completeness of the dissolution. When applied to the previously leached Fangataufa sediment, it showed very little highly insoluble plutonium was still remaining following the sequential leaching. And future work should include the application of this fusion procedure to all of the previously leached reference materials, so the two NIST reference materials and the moss soil from IAEA. So in overall summary, we looked at the extraction chromatography method verification. We saw no unexpected breakthrough of any tracers and recoveries matching those of Maxwell et al. Except for plutonium. And for the reagent interference, we saw most recoveries for control samples were above 75%. For sequential extraction verification and capability expansion, the standardized procedure was verified except for a few minor discrepancies. These were just some reaction parameters that will need to be better defined before we can classify this procedure as standardized. And we saw obvious differences in the leaching distribution per fraction based on the element extracted and the geochemical host phase of the reference material that it was extracted from. For the addition of a 6 fraction for complete dissolution, we saw problems with the EPA soil method, and the fusion method was recommended for complete dissolution. So future work is basically just focusing on wrapping up things that were missing from this work and investigating other problems that came up. So investigating thorium elution behavior beyond stripping of thorium when we were verifying this extraction chromatography procedure. Also complete the sequential extraction reagent interference studies for thorium. We'll need to investigate the pre-column valence adjustments to an attempt to account for the losses in plutonium from the separation procedure. We also need to create better defined reaction conditions for the pretreatment of the soil and the organic target phase for the sequential extraction. Perform a total dissolution, so the fusion, on all the previously leached reference materials. And finally, investigate the extraction of americium, uranium, and thorium from the IAEA reference materials. So finally, I would like to acknowledge the Nuclear Science and Security Consortium for funding this work. I've had several students help me with this work over the course of my time here. So I'd like to acknowledge them. When we work with hydrofluoric acid at UNLV, we need buddies, and they can be hard to find. So I would especially like to thank everyone that has been my HF buddy over the past few years, especially in 2012 when I personally couldn't work with hydrofluoric acid because I was pregnant. So then I had to find two buddies at the same time, which is rather difficult. And finally, support for the radiochemistry program and the health physics program. Mary Turner for running the labs for the health physics program and the counting labs. Julie Bertoya and Trevor Lowe for keeping the radiochemistry labs running, and Wendy for everything else, for travel, for ordering supplies, and all of that. So this is our radiochemistry group at UNLV. I'd like to thank each and every one of them. Here's a couple of references for this work. And then finally, thank you. I'll take any questions.